Hi, we are all living in the digital world. The internet surrounds us all across, and we take it as for granted in our lives. In fact, internet, according to me, is the single biggest development in human history after the advent of fire. But the advent of cyberspace has brought in far more new parameters. In fact, right from 1969, when ARPANET came into existence, this entire paradigm started developing in a very rapid manner. But the coming of the World Wide Web actually completely changed the manner in which people would access the internet. Those days, it was considered to be Wild Wild West. That means it was open to anyone to do whatever they want to do. Those were the days people would earn millions of dollars for one particular domain name. Now, from those days, things started moving slowly. In fact, I would call those days the days of the Wild Wild West. Why? Because those days, there was actually no law and order onto the internet. And that's the tipping point for which governments started thinking, it's time to really start for some orderly behavior in cyberspace. And that's where the beginnings of cyber law as a discipline evolved. In fact, the state of Utah became the first state of the United States of America and the world to come up with a cyber law in place. And from that time onwards, we began seeing the emergence of this new discipline of law, which we today call as cyber law. In fact, cyber law has the word cyber as an integral component thereof. The word cyber, emanating from the 1984 novel, today has a much bigger ramifications. In fact, today, the term cyber law is defined as the law pertaining to the use of the internet, the World Wide Web, as also the use of activities done in cyberspace. The ambit of cyber law as a discipline has dramatically increased. From those days of mid-90s till today, cyber law today engulfs almost all legal aspects and issues concerning the use of electronic and the digital format, as also the use of computers, computer systems, computer networks, computer resources, communication devices, as also data and information in the electronic form. This is one discipline of law that is continuing to develop as we go forward. But the fact really remains, where are we today as far as cyber law in the world? Primarily because cyber law as a discipline has quietly moved and has taken an integral central role in our day-to-day lives. In fact, the United Nations General Assembly actually went ahead and adopted the UNCTAD Modern Law of Electronic Commerce and encouraged all member nations to come up with national laws to deal with e-commerce and connected legalities. From then, countries started coming up with their own distinctive national approaches on e-commerce legislation. The UNCTAD Modern Law on Electronic Signatures only further encouraged countries to look at issues pertaining to electronic authentication. But still, by and large, countries were not very clear which direction they were going. Cybercrime as a phenomenon was emerging. And as the cybercrime phenomenon was emerging, it was purely felt that you would require legal frameworks to regulate these so-called cybercriminal activities. So what did countries do? They started coming up with their own national laws, e-commerce laws, which also had components to deal with regulating cybercrime matters. But while all this was happening, something else also happened. Cyberterrorism evolved onto the global stage. And coming of cyberterrorism actually meant that countries must start addressing it. So different countries came up with different national provisions to deal with cyberterrorism as a phenomenon. That was going on fine, and then suddenly we realized one thing, that internet made geography history, and that cybercrime is a transnational crime, and without international cooperation, it's not going to work. Primarily because sitting from one end of the internet in the globe, you can actually target and attack the second end. Having said that, therefore, international cooperation started becoming more and more significant. The world quickly realized that we did not have an international cyber law in place. So they started coming up with mechanisms to provide for more cooperation amongst law enforcement agencies. The mutual legal assistance treaties came along and were just about beginning to address the concerns of the stakeholders. Then the Budapest Convention came across in 2001. The Council of Europe's Convention on Cybercrime is the singular instance of the most successful international treaty on cybercrime prevention. Today, with more than 45 nations having being a part of this signatories of this Budapest Convention, this particular convention has laid the foundations for further progress as far as cybercrime jurisprudence was concerned. But while all this was happening, something else came across. The cyber criminals suddenly realized that time has now come to start targeting sovereign nations. And therefore, cyber security breaches became an important component. Well, if you look at the statistics, the quantum of cyber security breaches kept on increasing with each passing month. And therefore, the cyber security regulatory aspects became of critical necessity and importance for all stakeholders. So countries have now begun to start incorporating cyber security legal provisions as an integral component of their cyber legal frameworks. And that's why cyber security law has developed as an important component of the overall umbrella of cyber law jurisprudence as a whole. Well, that looks nice, but where does it take the world today? Well, today the world is at crossroads. The mutual legal assistance treaties are not really functioning very well because it takes a lot of time. The expectation of the stakeholders is that things must instantaneously be resolved. Now, more so when the anonymity on the internet is providing the virtual platform for the cyber criminals to go ahead and attack sovereign nations, the challenges are far more. December 2015, the grid of Ukraine was attacked by hackers. And as on date, it's been confirmed that the hackers had infiltrated to great levels. So in a scenario like this coming in, the issue is, how do you deal with this entire issue of internet jurisdiction? Well, unfortunately, today at the time when I'm talking with you, there's not one particular, shall I say, agreement on what exactly would really constitute the international agreement on internet jurisdiction. But work continues to keep on happening. So what's happening? The country started realizing there's no international cyber law in place. We have our own national cyber laws, but these national cyber laws are not talking with each other. So how do we go forward? Then the Snowden revelations came, and the world quickly woke up to a new reality, a reality that state and non-state actors were now increasingly willing to go to great lengths to listen to your conversations, to access your data per se. And that's the reason why the world has now started looking at a new phenomenon, a phenomenon where countries have started engaging in bilateral arrangements. They realize there's no international cyber law in place, so let's go for bilateral arrangements. The United States and China came across with one such mother agreement so that both countries agreed not to really assist in activities which will target the computer networks of the respective countries. Well, there have been other agreements, but these bilateral agreements, while a step forward, have not really been the right answer. They can be an initial feel-good factor, but global problems have to be dealt with at global levels. And that's why now new challenges have started coming up. The Internet of Things is the next big thing that's going to hit the internet person. It's not necessarily new. People have been working on the Internet of Things. But imagine a network which is not just connected by your computers, or mobiles, but which is connected by intelligent smart devices. Well, Gartner is saying that as of now, it's more than 6 billion devices which are going to be connected to the internet by the end of 2016. By the time we reach 2020, it's expected that more than 20 billion devices will be connected to the internet. What happens in such a scenario? How do we look at the legal issues pertaining to privacy protection, data protection, and individual rights. Well, how much are you going to be held responsible if your refrigerator entered into a smart contract with another vendor and actually ordering for you certain groceries which should be attributable to your account, but would it make you legally liable? Is it a violation of your privacy? How much work has to be done? And what kind of a balance do we require to do? And those are important issues that the Internet of Things is knocking up to the world cyber law regime stage. Well, there are no final answers. Good things is, these are works in progress. But yes, the national data protection laws are now increasingly getting challenged to say, how do these existing data protection laws are going to be applicable in the context of the Internet of Things? Internet of Things, still understandable. But what about the darknet? That's one area that's a complete taboo to talk. Why? Because the governments don't want to talk about it, and a lot of other people don't want to talk about it. Well, the darknet is that portion of the network which is not really accessed by superficial web search engines, and you require a separate browser to go inside, known as the onion router browser or the Tor browser. Now, the Tor browser is fabulous. It actually hides you behind various layers of anonymity. But then the darknet has today evolved into a different paradigm altogether. A lot of people want to go to darknet for legitimate purposes because they don't want their movements to be monitored by state and non-state players. But then darknet has suddenly become the ground for cybercrime economy. In fact, cybercrime as an economic model is the de facto model onto the darknet. And in a scenario like this, the bigger challenge before cyber legal frameworks is, how does cyber law deal with the challenges of anonymity onto the darknet? Can you say that you have a right to be anonymous and you have a right to engage in all criminal and illegal activities and also have a right not to be prosecuted or not to be gone after? I think that's stretching the argument a bit too far. But how do you, as legal frameworks, pierce through the anonymity veil to the darknet? More significantly, how do you create the relevant incriminating electronic evidence nexus chains to show that this particular legal entity had done that particular criminal activity onto the darknet? So that's one big area that countries are slowly waking up to. And my personal belief is that cyber law as a discipline will have to now quickly race up to identifying the legal mechanisms of how to deal with the challenges of anonymity onto the darknet and with the entire issue of ensuring that the darknet continues to be a good place for anonymous, legitimate, genuine users, but does not become a place for the purposes of ensuring that criminal activities can be done without any inhibition and can continue to be perpetuated without any fear of any retribution or any legal proceedings otherwise. So darknet is one big issue that the world needs to wake up to. Another big important issue that the cyber law frameworks need to really wake up is the issue pertaining to cloud computing. Today is a new paradigm. The world is moving to the cloud. Cloud is secure. That's what cloud service providers say. But outages do happen. And what happens to your legal rights in case if your data resident on cloud somewhere is breached, compromised, or just not made available? Now, most of the time, the guys don't land up reading the fine print into the contract. But then, those are issues that require yet to be appropriately addressed as time really passes by. In fact, I actually would like to classify this current age as the age of SMAC, which is smart, mobile, analytics, and cloud. I think these are the flavors of the day. But cyber law, as a discipline, needs to address each one of these aspects. Why? Because we are taking the SMAC for granted. But are we beginning to realize what kind of actual effect does SMAC have on your privacy? Personal privacy, data privacy. What about data protection? What about your intellectual property rights? What about your online rights? Those are big issues that have yet to be specifically addressed in detail. And that's why I revert back to my original argument that cyber law is a work in progress. Well, the coming of mobiles has really brought forward a completely new paradigm. In fact, it's so important that the world is believing mobility to be its mainstay. The mainstay of its existence, of its commercial operations. And that's why mobile web has suddenly grown forward. Let's take the case of India. 67% of all Indian online users only access the internet through their mobile devices. So mobile web is going to be huge, is already huge, and will continue to be even more bigger in the coming times. However, the advent of mobile web brings across its own very distinct legal policy and the regulatory challenges. Those, again, also need to be appropriately addressed. And that's the reason why I personally believe that mobile law is becoming an important subcomponent of the overall discipline of cyber law as a whole. Now, in today's scenario, when there is so much of distrust and mistrust amongst nations of the world, it's very difficult to get an international agreement in place. There have been discussions going on the rules of the law. But the question arises is, does the world need an international convention? My personal belief is that the world today needs an international convention on cyber law and cyber security. It will be hard to really negotiate an international treaty, but the best way going forward could be, let's look at the common denominators, the low-hanging fruits, those common accepted principles which countries across the world are accepting. Collate them together and that become the basis for the further development of an international jurisprudence on cyber law and cyber security. Clearly, the world is currently going through very, very transient and turbulent times. In these turbulent times, the world, stakeholders, as also state and non-state actors, are looking upon to cyber law as an evolving discipline as to how it is going to help contribute in making internet a far more better, secure, orderly place to be in. And that's one particular area that the world needs to work on. There has to be tremendous focus on world cooperation. As the focus of the internet has shifted from the West onto the East, and when India and China have come up as big markets for e-commerce and m-commerce across the world, there's a need for harmonizing cyber legal frameworks in such a manner so as to ensure that there's a balance between competing interests, of ensuring that the sovereignty of countries is not impacted, and also ensuring that there's appropriate balance with protection and preservation of online rights, liberties of people as a whole. Clearly, this is a fascinating space as far as cyber law evolution is concerned. This discipline is going to continue to keep on going, and give yourself the next few decades, we're going to see some fascinating developments in this newly evolving space of cyber law, which is going to impact the lives of all of us. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.